All right, so we talked about separable filters, right? And the nice thing about separable filters is that they're incredibly quick, right? And this means that, for example, in computer games, you could actually do some of this on a graphics card at 60 frames a second, right? These are the kind of things that people who are writing computer games, not me, people who know what they're doing writing computer games are thinking about, right? How can we do post-processing like motion blur and bloom and other kinds of filters that look good in a game but don't grind the whole thing to a halt? Separable filters are a great way of doing this. The problem is that Gaussian blur, which is the thing we kind of focused on, doesn't look that good as a blur, right? If you say, well, I want to do some depth of field, I want to do some optical depth of field, right? So I want the foreground person in my game to be nice and sharp, and I want the background to be lovely blur, right? It will look a bit odd if you use a Gaussian, because that's not what a lens does. You need to use a proper bokeh blur. I don't know how to pronounce that word.
Bokeh is right, yeah.
Bokeh, right, bokeh. I lost interest. It's because of the way that the optics of a camera work, right? So a Gaussian, your point is spread over a sort of Gaussian function, so it decreases like this, right? That's not what happens in an optical blur, right? A lens blur. So if we remember back to, a while ago, we did a light field video. You've got a point light source here, which is something in your scene, a person, a light, a tree, not important, right? There's gonna be quite a few of these if your image has more than one pixel in it. You have a lens, right, which looks like this. It might have other glass optical elements, and you have an imaging plane here like this. And what happens is, point light don't just travel directly into your camera. Everything just emits light in lots of directions, right, depending on its properties. So it comes in like this, right, and when it's in focus, it will come and it will hit a point on here, and that pixel will obtain that color. The color will be the sum of all of these light rays, and then sort of simplified to be usually between 0 and 255. If you're out of focus, what will happen is these light rays will come past the camera like this and focus on a point behind it. And actually, you'll have this light will now be spread over this whole area. From the front, if this is the front of our square sensor, every point will now be a circle like this. And each other point will also be a circle and another circle and another circle. And this gets you that kind of characteristic lens blur that you see when something like light sources, Christmas tree lights or something, are out of focus, right? Cut to a nice shot of this. So people spend a lot of money on lenses, primarily, I think, because of the quality of this kind of blur. They're not perfect circles a lot of the time. Sometimes they're slightly odd, or they're hexagons because you've got an aperture and things like this. They give this blur a sort of unique characteristic, even down to a lens, which you can't really get on a computer. But we can have a go, because we've got to do it at 60 frames a second. We haven't got the option of thinking about Zeiss and Leica. Although this is most obvious when you're looking at point lights, actually this applies to any blur, right? If you do a Gaussian blur of a scene that doesn't have very bright bits, it will still look a bit different than if you have a normal bokeh blur, right? And actually, it'll look much better if you do it properly. Can we recreate our separable filters, but now perform a lens blur, or at least an approximation to a lens blur? And the answer is, it's not so easy, but you can kind of have a go. You have to start looking at imaginary numbers a little bit, but if we just sort of not worry about it too much, you essentially replace your separable convolutions with two complex separable convolutions, and we can start to get something going. So one particular game engine that does this is EA's Frostbite engine, which drives a lot of its sports games. So things like Madden will have a nice blur on certain shots that's created by an artificial lens blur, not a Gaussian blur. Other games might kind of fake it with a bit of a Gaussian. I don't approve of that approach. It's not technically correct. There's a kind of short paper on this. There's a few blogs online that talk about separable lens blur. There's some implementations out there. I've got my own implementation that I wrote, which I'll release at the end of this video. There was a nice presentation at the Game Developers Conference in 2017 showing off this technology, right? So this is real-time bokeh blur, not Gaussian blur, right? So how does it work? Well, the idea is that what we want to do is, instead of having our kernel, which is sort of like this, and a Gaussian, we need to have it be a circle, right? In an ideal world, that, right, which from the top looks like a nice clear-cut circle. Now you can do that, but you can't separate it. You could have a kernel which is just a load of zeros and then a circle of ones in the middle, and that will produce you a very nice filter, but it will take ages because you have to do all this point-wise and it's not separable. So what we need to do is find a function that we can split into a vertical pass and a horizontal pass. Right. Let's look at an example, right? One of the nice things about Gaussian is that it's separable, right? It's a naturally separable function. So how can we convert a Gaussian into something that kind of approximates this circular shape? And the answer is that we can sort of add an imaginary component and create a sort of complex Gaussian, right? Now, obviously we're not going to go into a huge amount of detail on complex numbers, but they have an imaginary and a real component. The imaginary component is multiplied by I, which is the square root of minus one. The good news for us is that most of the time when we actually need to use it, the I's get multiplied out and they sort of disappear or become a minus number, right? That's all the detail I'm going to go into. Actually, it's a bit like when we talked about our discrete cosine transform and when maybe sometime we'll talk about Fourier transforms. We have waves that add together to create something the shape we want, right? In this case, the wave is going to be a Gaussian, right? But it's going to go up and down like this. So instead of our Gaussian going like this, which is not quite centered, but we won't dwell on it, we have one that goes up and down, right? And the complex component of this Gaussian is the bit that makes it do that. So we have a Gaussian that sort of goes down like this and sort of centers around here, and this comes down like this, right? It's symmetrical. And then we have another one that perhaps comes sort of like this, like that. And when you add them together, you get the thing we want. So these kind of cancel out and you sort of get something that looks a bit like this with a bit of wobbling around, and then it comes up about here and then kind of goes like that and then down like that, right? And that is our circle. Right. And that is also separable because it's essentially got a Gaussian as its sort of primary function. So I've coded this up and I've been using it to mess around with different blurs. Most of the code is to do with creating the kernels. I do some normalization and things like this. Then I pass the image through each component, and at the very end I combine them, right? And I'll draw a little diagram to show how that works. The more components you use, a bit like in JPEG or any kind of sort of adding of waves, the more waves you use, the better approximation you're going to get, right? So if you're not writing this for a game engine, you can only use maybe two. Each time you do this, you've got quite a few convolutions you're gonna have to do. These are complex multiplication operations in addition. It takes time, even on a graphics card, right? And bear in mind, there's other game things to do, right? The game isn't static with just this nice blur. So you've got other stuff to be worrying about. The fact that there's an imaginary number involved, in some sense, to me anyway, personally, I like to look at it as basically not making any difference at all. The only difference is that the addition and multiplication that you would normally do in a convolution is now a complex addition and a complex multiplication, which are sort of well-defined structures that you can just apply.
And this is a mathematical term, not just us saying it's difficult.
It's absolutely a mathematical term, right? And it's actually not very complicated. You have your image, right? We have our first component, C0, here, and we have another component, C1. We could have lots of others. This has a complex kernel, so that will have a real and an imaginary, right? But they're just going to look a bit like Gaussians, like I showed you. This is going to be the same over here. These are different ones. And the idea is that when we add these two together, we get a very nice disk. So what we're going to do is we're going to convolve this image with these, and we're going to convolve this image with these, and we're going to add them together at the end. There's actually a lot of addition goes on, right? So we take our image, we go through here, and we get another image out, which is our real, and another image out, which is our imaginary. We go through here, we get an image out that's real, an image out that's an imaginary, and then we add these two together in a weighted sum, and then we take our final weighted images for each component and we add them together in our final output like that. The reason we have to do these separately is so that we can make it separable, right? This can be done separably, this can be done in the same way, very, very quickly, right? If you're doing it for just two components, there's a few convolutions you have to do, add it all together, and you have your result. The separability means that instead of doing all the kernel for every location, we do a vertical pass of a strip, and we take that output and put it through a horizontal pass, and then we combine the outputs at the end. And that's mathematically equivalent to doing the 2D version, but much faster. So let's have a look at some outputs, right? Now, I've written some code here, fairly straightforward, that essentially produces these complex kernels in one dimension and can apply them to an image, you know, in the correct order, add them up at the end so we can blur some images. You know, I'll release the code so you can have a look. The original post that led me to this work outlined a few parameters for these kernels that looked good, right, that he'd optimized. So I put them in as well. So let's have a look at a couple of these kernels and see what they are. So if I just look at the zero, the one component pass, right? So this is if you want to try and create a disk with just one of these complex kernels, right? What will it look like? Well, let's have a look. These are the real and imaginary parts of this particular component. And this is going to look roughly like a disk when we add these two together. Let's see. So if I take the two together, we can run it, and it's kind of a donutty disk, right? And the reason is because you can't get a perfect disk with just a real and imaginary part added together. It's not going to work. So what we can do is we can take another kernel, add that to it, and now we've got kind of two reals and two imaginaries in some loose sense, add these all together, and maybe we can start to approximate this disk, so we'll get a little bit better. If I change this and run that together, right? So now it's got a bit of a ripple to it, but this is starting to look quite a lot better, right? This looks to me quite a lot like the disk I'm hoping for, and this is still separable. So I can take a strip from the middle and a strip here, and I can run it in two passes and save a huge amount of time. Because this is a sort of a, this is I think a 64 or 65 by 65 pixel kernel. This would be a big deal if you wanted to run this over an image. Especially, you know, at a sort of resolution that modern games run at. So we can get even better. We can add more and more components. So if I ramp up the number of components, right, we get something that looks really, really quite good. There we go. So this now looks, I think, quite a lot like a disk. So essentially, this is equivalent to running a circle of ones in a convolution over an image. It's just that now we can do it in these separable components and save ourselves a huge amount of time. It's not perfect, right? The size is difficult to manage. The edge is not as sharp as I'd like. This should be a sharp edge, but you can't get an absolutely sharp edge. But for a sort of game engine, something in the background, it's going to look great. And it's going to run really, really quick. In the in the Frostbite engine, they'll only use two components. So it won't be a perfect kernel, but it will look pretty good. Stars are a classic example of somewhere where you can use this blur, because of course they're point lights, so they nice spread out nicely. So this is what happens if we Gaussian blur this image. It looks dull and like just like not high resolution. It doesn't look great, right? If we look at the lens version, I mean, I think it's aesthetically better, right? When it looks like this, right? Each of these points has spread out into a nice disc. I've had to do some exposure here because that's difficult to do, but I think it looks pretty good. So that's the Gaussian and that is the lens blur. I think that looks a lot better. So this is our fake lens blur by using our circular disc kernel with lots of components because I wasn't worried about speed, right? Even if you did it with two components, it would still look good. So if you were running this in a game, what you would do is you would start to separate out the foreground and the background of a scene. You'd blur anything you wanted to not be in focus and keep anything you did want to be in focus sharp, and then you'd start to bring them all together at the end by, you know, alpha blending or overlaying. So you sent me a picture of some Lego. So we've got a Lego man here on a table with some lights in a jar behind, right? So this is quite a good example of something we could try this out on. So you also, thankfully, gave me some foreground and background masks for this. So I blurred the background and I blended in the foreground as you might do in a game. But rather than code it, I kind of hacked it together in paint, right? But I think it looks really good. So this is our Gaussian attempt. So here, I've essentially taken the man away. I've blurred this using a Gaussian and I put the man back in, basically. And I mean, it looks okay. But if we flick to the lens blur, I think it looks a lot better, right? It looks a lot more like a true sort of bokeh blur you might expect from a lens. And so this is exactly what you'll see when you play FIFA and when you play PGA Tour and when you play Madden and any of these sports titles. When it cuts to a kind of nice depth of field shot, let's say in the instant replay, this will be at work behind the scenes. There's loads of different tricks. This is just one of them. I think this is really interesting because apart from the fact that I think this is quite mathematically elegant, right? Not everyone will agree. I just think it's cool that in these games and in, you know, they're doing all these little tips and tricks to make it run at 60 frames a second but still look really good. And you don't notice, right? No one really knows until you read up on it that Madden has a different depth of field approach to some other games. But maybe you just liked that a little bit better and you didn't know, and that's one of the things you liked about that game. And I just think that's really cool. That, you know, these things are going on behind the scenes that we don't know they exist, but they just make it a little bit better. What you think, right? So in this case, it's going through glass. The glass is moving things around. That is going to be lost a little bit in our blur. Another thing is that our disc is not absolutely sharp, right? And we can't approximate hexagons with it, so you can't do that kind of blur. But I think the main problem is that the exposure is very hard.